ओके CB meeting on accounting standards. Here I would like to acknowledge the presence of our chairman sir of WIRC CA Lalit Bajaj, our speaker sir CA Sanjay Banthia ji, and our coordinator Helisha. Welcome all to the virtual CPE meeting. Before moving on to the technicality of this topic, I would request our CA Lalit Bajaj sir, chairman of WIRC, to give the opening remark for the today's session. Sir, over to you.
Thanks, Sheetal. The learned expert for today's session, Sanjay Banthia ji, coordinators Sheetal, Heli, seniors, friends, and participants. At behest of WIRC, let me welcome all of you in this August gathering, whereby the subject which has been chosen by Sanjay ji is really so apt, because each and every one of us is really trying to ensure and comply as to any entity, whether what are the level of challenges we have faced in the last, say, a year's time, and how can we overcome those challenges, so that as far as the accounting principle of going concern is concerned, we as chartered accountants can report in a very in a true and fair view as far as this particular aspect is concerned. And Sanjay ji being on board, I am 101% sure that we all will be enlightened on this particular aspect while completing or say auditing the financial statements for the year ending 31st March 2021. We have been engaging into lot many activities and initiatives at WIRC since last so many months. And I believe you all have been abreast through our newsletter and websites on a regular intervals as to what all is happening at WIRC. And I have seen that you all have participated and contributed very well in all our initiatives taken at WIRC. I would just like to touch upon the latest publication which we released yesterday. The publication is Model Financial Statements for Non-Corporate Entities. The idea is that there is a huge MSME sector in India, which we as chartered accountants provide services and serve that sector as far as various compliances are concerned, to bring some uniformity as to the reporting in the financial statements is concerned. We have tried to come out with a crisp publication. I would urge all the members, do visit WIRC website. You will find the publication there. You can download it. You can refer it at any point of time. It will really be fruitful to all of you. And over and above this, there are a lot many things I can interact with you. But looking at the today's subject and Sanjay ji being with us, I would not like to take much of the technical session's time. I would just urge upon each one of you that if you have any suggestions whereby you feel that WIRC along with its members can really engage into, please write to us at wirc@ici.in. We will be more than fortunate to work on all your suggestions and to see that you can contribute and participate in all the activities. With this, I once again welcome all of you. And thanks Sheetal and Heli for really coordinating this wonderful program, because in this period whereby accounting standard or say any subject related to auditing or accounting is not on a front seat, but you have ensured that we get sufficient participation and huge support as far as this program is concerned. So thanks for your efforts And thank you once again, Sanjay ji, for being part of this program. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your words of wisdom. Now I would request CA Haley to give formal introduction of our speaker, sir. Over to you, Haley.
Good afternoon, one and all. Would like to brief about the speaker. Mr. Sanjay Vantia has an experience over 20 years in auditing financial reporting and corporate governance of various public and private companies. His primary focus is on leading audit engagement of various US listed SEC registrants, particularly in the IT, ITEs, and media sector, working on multi-location audit with multidisciplinary teams, handling clients working on IPOs in US and Indian market, leading engagement in IFRS and US GAAP conversion. But currently he is working as a partner and expertise champion for technology, media, telecommunication in the firm. He has experience, his experience include media, technology, gaming, real estate, retail, manufacturing, financial services, and IT, ITEs. And he's regularly, he's a regular faculty on NDAS standards with ICAI. Thank you so much. Over to you.
Sanjay sir, you may begin with the session.
Yeah, thank you very much, everybody. I'm just trying to do the share screen. It says I cannot share screen because somebody else is sharing the screen. So probably Vinay Mishra ji, if you could allow me to share the screen, please.
Allow ki aapko.
I hope the screen is visible. Thank you, everybody, and good afternoon to all my friends in the fraternity. Welcome to the session. The quick overview of the session is to talk about accounting and auditing implications that has come into play on account of COVID-19. Clearly, COVID-19 has been with us for about a year's time now, and we have somehow managed to deal with and live with COVID-19 and evaluating the implication of that from an accounting auditing perspective. I'll just move to the next slide. Just to kind of give you perspective before we really deep dive into going concern, because each of the aspects from an accounting perspective that gets impacted on account of COVID-19 somehow leads to evaluating the going concern under SA 570. So we'll talk briefly about few of those accounting implications before we deep dive into the going concern aspect, and then kind of look at few of the auditing nuances that come into play on account of COVID-19. Of course, when we talk about COVID-19, it is important to start with revenue recognition. Clearly, during these times, we have seen different industry, probably sub-industries within the industry, having different impact on account of COVID-19 impacting their volume discount, increasing or decreasing their revenues, increasing the sales return, changing the price discounts that they were offering. So a lot of that has happened during the period. So few industries have really gained well, particularly when you look at industry into artificial intelligence, you look at industry into online gaming. Those have had huge amount of revenue upside, whereas there are other industries like automotive and few others which did not do as good, primarily on account of the lockdown for the initial part of the year, and then subsequently the demand did not rise as much as we expected to. I think the three aspects that from an accounting and auditing perspective one needs to look into is existence of a contract, and more importantly, in case there are new customers, assess whether the collection is probable in respect of those contracts, particularly those customers which are in the region which are more affected by COVID-19, so that evaluation becomes a much more detailed evaluation compared to a normal day where having a signed contract would have been good enough. I would also want to highlight the second aspect, which has changed quite drastically in my understanding of how we have seen companies operating, is the variable consideration. Under Ind AS 115, one of the things that the company needs to identify is the price at which the transaction has occurred. And in that situation, any consideration that is an adjustment or a price paid back to the customer is adjusted to the price which needs to be accounted for as a transaction price. Any such adjustment, which could be in form of sales return, which could be on form of discounts given at later point in time, volume discounts given even with the lower volumes, etc., should be taken into account while computing the transaction price and accordingly recognizing the revenue. When you're doing that, particularly be very careful that it should be probable that a significant reversal will not happen or occur in subsequent period on account of discounts given. We've also seen situations where discounts have been given subsequently called for future transactions, but they in fact are transaction discounts pertaining to the past period altogether. So again, from a compliance perspective, this becomes a very key area of focus. But I think most importantly, what has impacted, and that's what most of the companies have done in the initial reporting that was performed for March 2020 audit, needs to be a little more detailed in March 2021 audit, is about the disclosures that are required under Ind AS 115. Ind AS 115 talks about the company to disclose the impact, timing of uncertainty, impact on cash flows, economic arising from economic factors or change in economic factors. Now, a lot of those disclosures and how did it impact the revenue recognition, the revenue stream, the way the revenue recognition happened, the way the revenues were defined, the change in product mix, etc., needs to be disclosed appropriately under the guidance of Ind AS 115. This guidance is more different under AS 9 revenue recognition standards under Indian GAAP from a disclosure perspective, although the first two aspects, which is, you know, your ability to make impact on account of variable consideration, may not be as applicable from an Indian GAAP perspective. The second item that would be relevant in our context would be to see how is the insurance claim, which is on account of loss of profit or something like that, is being accounted for in the books of accounts. Clearly, for the first few months between last year March till early June, when the lockdown continued and then the unlocking process started, created a huge amount of loss of profits for the businesses. In situations where there have been a loss of profit for businesses, the question that comes into play is there could be an insurance policy. The company would have made a claim towards losses incurred on account of such communicable diseases. Are they covered or not in the contract is something that we need to look at from an auditing perspective or from an accounting perspective. Even if they are covered in case where the contracts do cover them, the fact that there's a filing of an insurance claim is a contingent asset by itself does not mean that you need to recognize the income. Typically, the standard says you should recognize the income only when it's virtually certain. And typically, the yardstick to say it's virtually certain is when the claim is accepted by the insurer. And there has to be correspondence documentation to kind of see to ensure that those claims are being accounted for in the books of accounts. There have been some amount of government grants that's been provided during this point in time. We need to ensure that insurance claim on account of loss of profit is considered separate from the government grant or government assistance. Government grant and assistance should be accounted for under Ind AS 20 when it meets those recognition criteria under that standard. It's also important to understand that while on one side there would be an impact on how your revenues are operating or the fact that you incurred losses, you go back and make claims for that to the insurance companies. I think the reality is about you anticipate losses because you believe there would be reduction in demand. You will not be able to sell as much. The supply chain would be disturbed, which would cause delay and hence you may kind of need to pay penalties around that. And there could be an overall decline in the economic output, and that could also lead to losses, right? You know, you're not able to generate as much produce that you would like to be breaking it. Now, all of that would create anticipated loss for the future. Typically, such future operating losses do not meet the definition of liability under IS 37 or Ind AS 37 for the purpose of being recognized in the books of accounts today. needs to be very careful that there could be few of those items that could be onerous contracts. If they are, then one needs to account for the onerous contract liability in the books of accounts. But prior to doing or accounting for the onerous contract liability, one needs to ensure that an impairment of such onerous asset is being performed, and only post that an appropriate liability is recorded. I think what is more important is to ensure that appropriate disclosures are made around such items, about what the company believes could be onerous contract, and hence the reporting of that, as well as kind of look at the impact and accounting for restructuring costs when you kind of restructure the business because of the way it needs to be operating today. How has that been done? Now, a lot of these things, while would have happened into businesses quite usual in the day, just the veracity of these changes has increased, and one needs to be very careful in evaluating such items for the purposes of accounting in the books altogether. I think which leads to one of the final key points about the impairment evaluation under IAS 36 or Ind AS 36, which could be possible. The entire cause of such impairment indicators on account of COVID-19 could be disruption of supply chain, a restriction on operations, reduced demand, there could be decrease in price, there could be a change in existing supplier who was providing the supplies to you, the workforce is not fully available. On top of that, there could be a decrease in market capitalization, again, depending upon which industry you operate in. But all of that together could lead to change in assumptions that were used in calculating the discounted cash flow value of the company, therefore impacting the value of the company, impacting the outcome of broad spectrum of the value. It is on account of current economic scenarios. The discount rates that may have been used may have undergone a change because of the way the interest rates are going through. The forecast and budgets that the company prepared in using the discounted cash flow method may have undergone change. The market assumptions have undergone a change, and there could have been a reasonable change in other assumptions and reporting that would have happened during the period. So I think those are the things that could lead to potential risk of impairment, in which case an appropriate fair valuation at the balance sheet date is required to be done. That's what is required from an accounting standard perspective. As much as it's too important, or I would say relevant, to kind of look at all the non-current assets, is to also look at deferred tax asset. Typically, any of these changes could lead to change in the underlying cash flows, which may require that the deferred tax asset, which have been recognized based on the initial assessment that they are convincing evidence to recoup them over the longer period of time, would have undergone change. They could have undergone change on account of change in future projections. They could have undergone change on account of the earnings that is there in the foreign entities, and how the tax strategy would be applied by the company. And the company may also get the tax waivers or deferrals by the government at some point in time, either in our country or in the subsidiaries of the entities or Indian companies operating outside that of India. So all of that is possible. And hence, one needs to look at all the economic outlooks that could deteriorate the value of deferred tax asset. If any of those do, then the deferred tax asset recognized should be reversed. We should also kind of look at Ind AS 109, which talks about accounting for the financial assets at fair value. And they may require you to account them, if you would remember, either at fair value through P&L or fair value through OCI, when you meet those conditions. Such securities could be level one securities, which are quoted market price. You have an active market price to be used for them, versus some other set of investments which are into level two and level three. How and which technique do you use at this point in time, apart from DCF? Are there better techniques to kind of look into, corroborate, is something that needs to be looked into from a COVID-19 perspective. Now, again, what would also change from a financial asset reporting perspective is that if there is an expected credit loss that one would have created on accounts receivable, you could have chosen to do a 12-month ECL versus lifetime ECL. Now, have those conditions changed when you're accounting financial asset at amortized cost, both in terms of the current versus non-current evaluation, any potential regulatory requirements that could impact the value of assets reported, impact on investment in subsidiaries individually and at a consolidated level, and relevant disclosures in respect of how the financial assets, either accounted at fair value or at amortized cost, have been appropriately reviewed from a fair valuation perspective. So what COVID-19 would also do is that it would lead to a decline in revenue, or it could lead to a higher operating cost. It could lead to changes in cash flows. All of this will have an impact from a perspective of companies' ability to repay the debt when they fall due, which could be looked into from a perspective that there's a financial ratio that's not being good, or the impact on cash flow that you're not able to repay the interest or principal EMIs on time, or the fact that your financial ratios are disturbed to an extent that you are not complying with the debt covenants. Any of these situations could lead to two aspects. One, it could lead to a significant modification, or it could lead to debt extinguishment on account of the relevant requirements under Ind AS 109. The critical aspect out here would be to assess, are the changes that have happened to the debt the company has undertaken, are they substantial enough for it to be regarded as a modification versus extinguishment? In case of modification, the gain or loss is taken through P&L. In case of extinguishment, the old liability is extinguished and the new liability is accounted for. This could lead to a difference in accounting into the profit and loss account for the gain or loss that arises on account of modification or extinguishment. What would also undergo change is your hedge accounting policies. While the companies could continue to do hedge accounting, they may have forward contracts for the future forecasted transactions that needs to be evaluated for two aspects. What is the certainty of those future forecasted transactions happening? And even if they do happen, whether the hedge effectiveness assessment would remain same or not. Well, we have seen a lot of companies taking forward contracts, and these forward contracts were hedged under 109 for the purposes of accounting, and therefore could lead to increase or decrease of volatility in the profit and loss account for such ineffectiveness being recorded in the books of accounts. It would also, I would say, relevant to estimate the fair value of derivatives with a special attention to the underlying assumptions used for where valuing the derivatives. We have also seen situations where the companies would have rebalanced or discontinued the hedge accounting. And if that's the case, that would lead to an appropriate impact on the P&L along with disclosures on the movement of hedge reported numbers. So that needs to also be done when such situations arise. So just to kind of give a brief summary before we deep dive into the main focus areas, why was it important to talk about a few of these accounting issues is to understand that the going concern uncertainty could arise on account of a lot of these accounting implications that we talked about, right from decline in revenue and how do you kind of deal with that, or you kind of look at how your hedge effectiveness has impacted you, or the impairment assessment that has undergone. All of that are just facet of indicators. These disruption to the global and local economies, the risk factor related to estimation has just gone up. That's all what all of these items are trying to help us, which increases uncertainty. And such uncertainty could lead to the risk, increase the risk of entities' ability to continue as a going concern. Let's also look at potential indicators that may be triggered, which could be on account of operational restrictions, particularly when there are limited opportunities to move in, move out. The plant was shut down for a few times. There was underutilized capacity for large part of the year. Economic slowdown was seen in the first 6-8 months. After the COVID-19 hit our country, there were several violations of debt covenants, although you know there were extension of these debt repayments being done, yet the covenants were getting breached on account of operating margins not being reported by those companies. There were delay in payment or non-payment of statutory dues or employee dues in a lot of cases, a substantial decrease in revenues. There could have been a loss of significant supply chain that was the basis of your business itself. There could be a sharp decline in the market cap. Now, a lot of these are only potential triggers. That by itself does not mean that a going concern uncertainty exists, but requires the company to make a detailed evaluation as to why they believe these indicators, even if they exist, will be mitigated in one or the other way for the purposes of evaluating going concern uncertainty. What it requires companies to do largely is to update their cash flow projections for the change in assumptions and estimates that's taken place, because that's the most important thing to do during these times. It also requires the impact of COVID-19 after the balance sheet date to be considered, which is, you know, what we kind of seen subsequent to March 21. If that continues to change, you have to take that into account. Requirement to provide disclosures in the notes to accounts, particularly if the management concludes that substantial doubt exists, but they have appropriate plan to address the substantial doubt, or they've already kind of taken into account how to adjust the substantial doubt. I'm just kind of putting toward the perspective of what are the different scenarios that could exist in respect of entities' deteriorating situation. This is again pretty much one of the key recent discussion in the IAS committee on the application of IS-1 or IND-1, which talks about the scenarios. So first scenario could be there's no significant doubt about going concern. The second scenario could be the significant doubt about going concern exists, but mitigating actions judged sufficient to make the going concern appropriate. So the entity determines no material uncertainty exists. The third situation is a significant doubt about going concern exists, mitigating actions just sufficient to make going concern appropriate, but material uncertainty about going concern remain after considering mitigating actions. And the fourth is the intent is to liquidate or to cease trading, or the fact that there's no realistic alternative but to do so by the organization. In situations 1, 2, 3, the basis of preparation is just going concern assumption that's been taken under IS-1 or IND AS-1. There's no change that needs to be done from an accounting and reporting perspective. But if you look at the disclosures in option 1 or situation 1 or scenario 1, you just kind of do a basis of preparation. There's no specific disclosures that you do. In case of scenario 2, the basis of preparations exist. You talk about the significant judgment being considered by the company in evaluating there are no material uncertainties around the going concern. In scenario 3, there are 3 aspects that come into play. One is a basis of preparation that's ongoing concern. The fact that there are material uncertainties exist in spite of the fact that there are mitigating actions considered, which do not necessarily negate all the material uncertainties. But the fact of significant judgment made by the company in respect of continuing to prepare the financial statements using going concern assumption. Now, these are the cases which are close calls, where the company needs to determine why they believe that they would be able to overturn for a particular period. You should also remember how the standards talk about going concern. They talk about the company should be in position to continue as a going concern for at least 12 months from the date of financial statements. The way or varied application that we have seen also includes typically companies believing that 12 months from the date the financial statements are authorized for issuance, which is typically the date when the audit report is signed and the financial statements are approved by the board of directors. So you take 12 months from that period. And hence the level of judgment applied out here, as well as the uncertainties that caused the company to still get to that conclusion, needs to be very elaborately detailed under IS-1. Clearly, if there is no alternative apart from liquidating or seizing the trading, it's not a going concern. So you have to use an alternative basis. Ind AS 1 does not define what the alternative basis could be. In practice, we have seen companies applying liquidation basis of accounting, which means all assets and liabilities are accounted, believing how much cash could come into the company subsequently. And that's the basis of accounting that's done. There are very limited specific requirements in respect of disclosures under Ind AS 1 or IS 1. But in typicalities, the fact that you chose the basis of preparation to be anything other than going concern, as well as the factors that led you to that accounting and the impact of the alternate accounting, needs to be well disclosed in the financial statements by the company altogether. So I would hold for a few moments out here, just to kind of see if we have any specific questions. Happy to kind of see them on the chat box. Let me also kind of put another sheet which will talk about the aspect of going concern and how the reporting would come into play. I'm sure this decision tree would have been seen at different points in time, but I think it's important to kind of run through this sheet altogether to ensure that it's well understood. So I think the question on going concern decision tree and how do you kind of report is based on the very basic fact, are there evidence that's sufficiently available from an audit perspective to determine that the going concern uncertainty is taken care of? If the answer is yes, you go back and say, are the financial statements prepared on the going concern basis? If the answer is yes, you say, is there a significant level of concern about entity's ability to continue as a going concern? If your answer is yes, are there multiple significant uncertainties? If the answer is yes, is this extreme case involving multiple significant uncertainties? You continue to disclaim. If no, the financial statements, do they include disclosures about these uncertainties? You give an unqualified opinion because material uncertainty paragraph is included, but the audit report is absolutely unmodified. If the period which is considered for going concern, do the financial statements give a true and fair view? If the answer is yes, you can go back and look at, is the period to which the directors have paid particular attention in assessing going concern less than 1 year? If the answer is yes, are the financial statements prepared under Ind AS's, IFRS's, is the period used disclosed? If all of the answers are yes, you kind of say unqualified opinion. Otherwise, you could, in the first place, if sufficient audit evidence is not obtained and there's a limitation, either you give a qualified opinion with an exception to limitation, or you end up giving a disclaimer depending upon whether the impact is pervasive or not. If the financial statements prepared on going concern basis, the answer is no. You have chosen alternative basis of accounting. You just kind of go back and look at, is the impact material and pervasive to financial statements? If the impact is not material or pervasive, you just give an exception for disagreement. If it is, then you give an adverse opinion. Let's take an example where there is appropriate disclosures not been made. We kind of give a qualified opinion in respect of our disagreement that the disclosures have not been made. If the disclosures made are the effect are pervasive, you kind of give an adverse opinion. I think those are the different ways in which the qualifications or reporting would happen, particularly in case of going concern. So you could see all kind of reporting, right from giving an unmodified opinion to giving a material uncertainty on going concern paragraph versus giving a this, I would say, qualified opinion on account of disclosures not being given or adverse opinion on account of that because the impact is pervasive, or the fact that you'll end up giving a qualified opinion for exception for limitation versus giving a disclaimer, or you could end up giving a qualification on the fact that the disclosures when you chose not to account under going concern are not appropriate, or you may end up giving an adverse opinion. So all form of audit opinions could exist in the given situation, particularly when the disclosures are not given more appropriately and the judgment that's been undertaken by the company is not articulated in the spirit of IS 1. I'll again go back and put the presentation up. So while we talked about the auditing aspect of going concern on account of COVID-19 and related other aspects from an accounting perspective, it's also important to understand the impact that it has brought onto the auditing considerations that needs to be taken into account. The impact on auditing consideration has been variedly impacting the way the practitioners have been reviewing the work under this environment, right from the remote auditing. You know, we know, as a matter of fact, a lot of work that we do today is got into remote auditing. We have not had chance to really step out as much as we would have loved to. And the chances that we'll go back to normal very soon is not there. So, which means that the March 2021 audit will be a partial remote audit, if not a large part of the audit being remote. We've also seen a lot of companies, particularly in IT, IDS industry, trying to kind of operate out of home in terms of their work culture. And hence, the work from anywhere has become the buzzword for many of these organizations. So clearly, remote auditing is going to be the most important aspect in terms of understanding how do we deal with that when we perform our work. It's also important to understand that the materialities based on which we perform the audit could also undergo substantial change. One, on account of declining revenues, companies not being able to make profits, and several changes in economic environment will lead to lower materiality, which should increase the professional skepticism when we kind of do the work. And there are several opportunities from a fraud perspective that would have inculcated during such period of economic slowdown. Inventory observation, while was a very critical aspect during the entire year, particularly for the March 2020 and then June 2020 audits or reviews, it's not as much of a challenge today, but it would still be some amount of challenge in the way the inventory observation or obsolescence will be performed. The entire realm of taking confirmations have also undergone change. Electronic confirmations have become more common these days as compared to sending couriers or using post. Internal controls review will also require significant change when you're using internal controls for the purposes of giving financial audit opinion, or you're giving an internal controls opinion for the companies which meet those requirements and needs. The sample size based on the statistical tool or any other method that's been described under the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India's guidance on auditing will also undergo a change. So you may end up kind of doing a lot more work compared to what you're doing in past. There are several service organizations who provide services to the customers or to our clients. How do we go about the controls residing with the service organizations will undergo a change. And in all, there could be a lot of change in the way we look at the going concern analysis from a documentation perspective needs to be a lot more robust. Which is the reason why Institute has come back with a lot of guidance talking about what they want the practitioners to do in this environment under ISA or SA 570. And clearly, a few of the other aspects I talked about needs to be taken into account when doing the evaluation from a going concern perspective. So we'll quickly jump into our professional skepticism and risk of fraud first, because in my mind, what has really changed during this period is the pressure on the management to report, if not a very healthy reporting, but enough to manage public expectation. So there would be a pressure to end up kind of reporting numbers which are not correct. That's the part one. The opportunities could exist on account of internal controls becoming weak when people are kind of operating using remote techniques. The rationalization is largely on account of the business being so severely impacted that, you know, doing some amount of unfair practices to report in such unprecedented times may not be considered to be as bad an idea. So typically you meet the basic fraud triangle. You meet the triangle where there are reasons why someone will do a fraud. There are opportunities based on which they will be able to do the fraud, and they will rationalize to say, look, what we're doing is right. And hence the number of frauds that would increase during this time could be high. In situations like these, from an audit background perspective, one needs to be very careful and review the risk of fraud more appropriately or in detail during the risk assessment phase of starting an audit. Now, this is not only applicable to us. This would be applicable even to the companies to ensure that they are able to see the companies are able to see, or within the company they have right ability to identify when such frauds do happen. So that is what is important. Now, why do we talk about fraud when we're talking about audit of going concern? The reason we talk about fraud today and the impact of fraud on going concern is primarily on the fact that when you, or as a company, when you kind of operate remotely, the fact that economic conditions are not well, one would end up kind of, the company or the management will be pushed or forced to do aspects of, use any of these measures to do wrong financial reporting. So if you go back and look at how fraud works, there could be two ways in which fraud works. One is the risk of embezzlement of assets and cash, which is not what we're talking about, but it's about inaccurate financial reporting. Now, the entire financial reporting framework is based on how the internal controls were placed. Majority of these internal controls that were placed in past were in an environment that was very different compared to what we are envisaging today. The entire environment of working through remote mechanics provides limited, relevant information to people at the time when they're approving the financial reporting aspects. And the fact that there would be, or there are these internal controls which are not designed for the current situation in which the organizations are operating, only provides an opportunity for management to override control and make any change in the financial reporting which is not accurate compared to what it requires to be. And which is a reason very important to understand this aspect, both from company's perspective as well as from auditor's perspective, that such understanding of risk as to what could go wrong from a fraud perspective, from an inappropriate financial reporting perspective, is the starting genesis of the entire audit work. And when you kind of do that, the intent is not to say something is wrong, but the intent is to kind of understand whether something could go wrong. And that is where professional skepticism interaction to this triangle comes into play. So So what we have also kind of, I'll talk you through, is about when you get into remote audit, what are the things that one should keep into account? And that's the reason the end result would be to exercise enhanced professional skepticism. And logically, few of the things that you need to think about is that a first time audit that you're doing, the initial engagement, or is it a recurring engagement? Particularly when you do initial engagement, you are not yourself as an auditor aware about the internal control procedures of the company, unlike recurring engagements where you are. But most importantly, you still need to understand how those controls have undergone change in situations like this. Two is the ability to work together remotely, because audits are typically done by a set of people in the team. It is impossible to kind of do audit individually. When you kind of do that along with your client, how do you remotely ensure that you're able to create the right work environment to understand really what's changed? Then is ability to supervise the engagement team. How do you guide them? What do you tell them? How should you document? The level of documentation needs to kind of be planned more appropriately. The fourth is complexity of the engagement. You could have simple audit engagement versus complex audit engagement, which operate into multi locations, both within the country and outside the country. It also depends upon availability of the electronic information. So the companies which are operating on high sophisticated IT systems, where all the documents are available on the IT systems and you have remote accesses to them, the risk of remote audit going wrong is lesser compared to companies which are using simple IT tools like Tally or NetSuite. Requires you to be more fundamentally grained to understand how those accounting reporting entries were recorded in the financial statements. And most importantly, I think the question is your ability to obtain the evidences in respect of by doing a lot of video and screen sharing techniques, which ensures not only that you are able to perform the work that you need to, but you're able to kind of see the person, talk to them, read their body language as you're having conversation with them. Now, all of that requires a level of professional skepticism to be enhanced to ensure that when you're performing this audit without meeting the person, without seeing him, without seeing the environment in which the individual are operating, you are able to ensure that those fundamental processes that's been applied by the individual by within the company and the organization are set more appropriately. So I think when you are using electronic information, it's important to understand the processes and controls that are producing the information, which means, are they photocopying? How are they photocopying? Who is doing that entire work? How is those loaded onto the IT systems? Assess the risk involved and perform suitable audit procedures under the given circumstances to ensure that you are able to take care of internal control that the company has built into place when such processes or controls are producing the information in electronic format for the purposes of documentation by the company and for the purposes of giving it as an audit evidence. When you obtain photocopied documents, right, in several places, compare with any verified original paper that you've got during your interim audit or previous year engagements, such comparison of the photocopied documents will help you to understand if the photocopied documents are in reality something taken from original papers, and evaluate the possibility of scope limitations when you're doing the review of such documents offline using whatever mediums you use to get those informations. Now, in situations that people could share screens on video live stream, or they could kind of meet you in person over Zoom or any of the other devices or apps, and then provide you all of that information, is very different compared to sending an email of a screenshot, which the possibility of tampering could be high. So like keeping your professional skepticism high, changing your audit accounting procedures or auditing procedures on such electronic information, which is produced by the company, and reviewing their internal control around it becomes very, very important. When you are, when we kind of go back and do a video or screen sharing technique, it's useful to do that in several circumstances. We have done that for observation of physical inventory counts, observation of performance of controls as to how the controls are being performed by the individuals, performance of walkthroughs to test the design of the control, obtaining the understanding of internal controls through conversation and then sharing the screen of how things operate on the IT systems or other than IT systems, a testing of operating effectiveness of those controls and performing inquiry, particularly in respect of fraud inquiries, by having a video screen conversation. The variety of forms of communication that are enabling more interactive audit engagement is what the need is today. And clearly using a video or a screen share technique is one of the most equipped tool which has helped to kind of keep us afloat in the auditing environment in today's age and today's time. Just wanted to kind of talk about each of the activities from a procedure perspective and how we've kind of or can look at performing them remotely. So when you look at analytical procedures, use spreadsheets or other analytical tools, and then investigate results using corroborative items in the financial reporting and corroborative tools. That's what is possible to do remotely from an analytical procedures perspective. On the confirmations, you can use electronic confirmations. Management can ask the contacts if they would prefer to use electronic confirmation versus paper confirmations. In terms of inspection, the scanning of hard copy items for review electronically, assessing the entity's IT systems externally, or using a real-time or live inspection of the technology using video, screen shares, et cetera, et cetera. Those are the few things that we could do from a procedure perspective in a remote audit environment. From an inquiry, usually use video rather than using the phone or email. Observations should be done using the real-time live viewing of technology, be it inventory or any process, control-related audit evidence. Recalculations could be done by obtaining the calculation in electronic form and then check them mathematically. You could reperform by obtaining the data electronically and then use the computer-assisted audit techniques to independently run the procedure or the control to see whether the results are same or not. So there are a lot of these techniques from a remote audit perspective that we could build into our audit, which could take care of inquiry, observation, recalculation, reperformance related aspect of the auditing things that we need to do. On the designing of external confirmation requests, particularly when we are taking external confirmation by means of electronic mode, it's very important to understand how should we make it more effective for us. Because paper form effectiveness is in a way you keep the control, so you kind of get the addresses, you send those post through addresses, the response come back to you. There are ways in which you kind of mark out the letters to ensure what was being sent is what has been received. Now, all of that needs to be done very differently in the electronic environment. So I think to kind of put that into three aspects, the method of communication, right? Electronic mode is of course more effective than paper form because, you know, it's between the two parties that you are clear about. Electronic confirmation process is also allowed by the auditing standards, so that's also not a problem. The process needs to be secured and the responses should be authenticated. Now, how do we ensure the process is secured? Typically, we need to ensure that the domain name to which we are sending is an existing domain name. We're not using Gmails, Yahoos, Rediff mails for the purposes of sending confirmations to the counterparty. And we verify that the email address and the domain names are appropriate or not. That's where we kind of make it authenticated. So that's very important when you do your method of communication. Your ability of the confirming party to confirm or provide requested information is very important. So you need to determine if the confirming party will have ability to receive confirmation through electronic form. Will they be able to assess the information that needs to be responded in electronic form? And if that is the case, is when you can use the external confirmation request using electronic form. What is the last thing that is important is the willingness to respond to a confirmation request containing management authorization. The management should authorize the use of authorized emails provided by the management. We need to also go back and check whether the email addresses provided by the management are tying with the underlying contract that the company has had with the counterparty. Does it talk about the email addresses? Does it talk about the information which is being provided to us of the individual who is responsible to respond back on the confirmations? And if possible, one should use digital signatures or electronic signatures, either of them, to ensure that the authorization performed by the management is more appropriate altogether. Now, all of this being there, there any additional procedures that would require you to apply skepticism needs to be looked into, particularly depending upon the kind of customers, vendors, clients, third parties from whom you need confirmations altogether. The next important thing is also to understand the internal controls. Clearly, the internal controls environment during COVID-19 would have changed substantially, particularly when we know the businesses have undergone change. The mechanics of doing the business will also undergo change. So the impact of COVID-19 on existing internal controls needs to be inquired. Interim internal controls that have been put into place during that particular period when there was lockdown needs to be assessed. If there were any changes to internal control to accommodate remote working arrangements, needs to be reviewed and understood. What changes were made from an IT controls perspective to enable remote workforces and yet ensure that there is no non-compliance with data sharing rules within the country. And the impact of entities' ability to properly segregate duties in an environment which is remote working altogether. Now, of course, when entities' ability to properly segregate duties in such environment do not exist, is where you would find that there would be an appropriate, weakness of controls that would lead to the rationalization aspect on the fraud triangle. In respect of pervasive controls, the controls that impact the overall financial reporting, are there any changes in oversight responsibilities? Who are supposed to do what? What have they done? Typically, entity level controls or pervasive controls, IT general controls or pervasive controls. So what has changed from an oversight responsibilities perspective? What is an impact on management and their ability to complete financial statement closing process in such environment? And what are the identification of risk related to COVID-19, how they've addressed as a company? All of that will be pervasive controls. And one needs to be very careful about any changes in the pervasive controls at the time and performing the test of internal controls. Inquiry is never sufficient by itself to evaluate design and implementation of relevant controls. Typically, if inquiry is not sufficient, which is you kind of go back and talk to the management team, you understand from them what you changed in the internal controls in an environment that works remotely. One needs to do from an audit perspective observation of activities by means of live image transmissions or observation of control activities carried via video recording or web meeting, or inspect the training materials, manuals, instructions, and so on that provides insight about the change of controls and how they were imparted to the employees who are supposed to perform those controls, or they could obtain electronic copies of the document to understand how those controls were executed by those staff who are performing those work altogether. So don't leave it to inquiry and documenting what's changed. Also ensure that either you're observing or inspecting or re-performing those design to see whether the controls were implemented in the relevant form. In terms of testing of operating effectiveness, once you've kind of tested the design, through the mix of inquiry, observation, inspection, and re-performance, when unable to assess audit evidence, the engagement team may need to go back and do additional work on substantive, because they can't place reliance on controls. So substantive procedures have to be a lot more detailed. The number of samples will increase. And the period when you kind of perform those testing from an interim strategy perspective, so the nature of audit procedures, the timing of audit procedures, and the extent of audit procedures could undergo a change. Now, this is only relevant for entities which are not meeting the guidance of doing internal financial controls reporting altogether. For the entities which are doing internal financial controls reporting, you would end up kind of qualifying the internal controls report and perform these additional procedures to ensure that those are either impacting or not impacting your financial statements audit report altogether. So I think what is also important is to understand how did you obtain audit evidence in respect to operating effectiveness in the past audits. That would require you to consider the effectiveness of other elements of internal controls, risk arising from characterization of the control, how much was automated, how much is manual, effectiveness of IT general control, the nature and extent of deviations in the application of the controls, which you noted in the past, a lack of change in a particular control that posed a risk due to change in circumstances, and the risk of material misstatement and extent of reliance on the control. So you need to look at all of that and how you evaluated them in the past period. But what it does is that it helps you to kind of identify whether you should be placing reliance on operating effectiveness control or not, in particularly for areas which are related to significant risk, or where the risk is high from a reporting perspective, and where the manual controls are not formally documented. Now, when you start the entire audit of remote, the entire audit during this remote environment, you go back and look at how you designed your testing of operating effectiveness in the past period. What are the conditions for those? What has changed by inquiry? You go back and also do observation, inspection, re-performance, and then perform the testing of operating effectiveness by getting relevant documentation across the board. If you don't have those information, you end up kind of qualifying the internal controls, and you do significant amount of work on the nature, timing, extent of such failure. On IT general controls, one of the most important thing is to see whether you can obtain sufficient controls or audit evidence in respect of controls remotely. Typically possible, but you know, when you do that, consider real-time image transmission for inspection. Obtain external access to IT system of the entity using VPN. Involve an individual with specialized risk or knowledge of information technology for the purposes of doing the aforesaid inspection from obtaining an audit evidence perspective. And change to IT general controls to enable extend the remote working arrangement needs to be specifically looked into, both in terms of what the changes were and how the changes were executed based on the approval mechanics within the organization. As highlighted, what all of this could have an impact, which would increase the sample sizes. As I highlighted, one is the inability to test the control of operating effectiveness for the entire period during the audit. Decreased financial statements materiality because of the company's ability or revenues decreasing, profits reducing, an increase in the risk of material misstatement at assertion level for a relevant assertion on account of the changes in economic environment. A lot of these things together could increase the amount of samples that you need to do audit of compared to what you did in the previous periods. Other factors that could reduce the sample size or improve effectiveness could be evidence obtained from analytical procedures or test of controls. Hence, the focus on doing corroborative analytical procedures and performing test of controls is very critical in the given time that we are in. Testing key items separately, so all the large items being tested separately will reduce the sample size for the untested population. Evaluate and understand population characteristics and identify subpopulations by kind of characterizing the population within subpopulation. You could focus on the subpopulation that impacts the most, therefore reducing the amount of time and effective work that you have to do on subpopulations which are not material or may not have such large impact. And one should consider use of interim or advanced strategy of test of details and controls, which helps you to reduce the overall sample size for giving you the same results on any substantive work. The next item that impacts, so while we've kind of talked about the internal controls of our organization and how it impacts the entire auditing in the remote audit environment, I think the second largest area of impact because of COVID-19 onto us is how we evaluate the impact of service organizations' controls on the financial report. But typically, financial reporting related work that the service organizations perform, as an example, includes organization performing your payroll processing or payroll tax calculation or external bookkeeping services. They're the most common ones. You also use external application service providers to develop and maintain your software, as well as you have trust departments for bank and insurance company that invest into their assets, transfer agents, custodians, and record keepers for investment companies. You have mortgage service and depository institutions that provide servicing of the loan and other items. Now, when you use a service organization, you need to be sure about what you need to do. Just kind of breaking that into risk assessment and planning, you need to read the usual manuals, system overviews, technical manuals, contract agreement with service organization, report on controls of service organization in the past period, all of that to ensure that you understand and obtain a right understanding of the nature of service the service organization is providing, materiality of the transaction which is being processed, is there a significant degree of interaction between the company and the service provider, and the nature of relationship. You get that understanding by doing the following activities. Then you evaluate the design and implementation of the relevant controls by the user entity. If there is a significant high interaction between the service or accounts or service provider and the company, you may not need a service auditor's report. But if the interactions are low, you may need to understand the controls, read the prior period service auditor's report, read communication between the service organization about its COVID-19 responses and the effects of that, and obtain a bridge letter if you don't have the audit report on the same date that the financial statements are being prepared. But typically, these are SSAE 16 reports that are obtained to ensure the design and effectiveness of the service organization is operating effectively. Audit evidence about operating effectiveness of control is either in form of type 2 report or perform POC by yourself at the organization test of controls, and or use another auditor who could perform POC at the service organization and report it to you. So you could use either of these three depending upon what is the most feasible thing to do in the given time. Or alternatively, you could visit the service organization to perform the relevant test yourself or test them remotely by yourself. So due to COVID-19, there could be an increased requirement number of type 2 reports with modified opinions, exceptions of caveats. And that could be a possible situation that you get to. Just because the service organization reports are modified or have exceptions or caveats by itself does not mean that it would have an impact on your audit. So you need to determine the impact on the controls relevant to your audit, which are getting impacted at service organization, discuss those matters with the service auditor, and then appropriately perform the risk assessment and identify the nature, timing, and extent of the work that you need to do to mitigate the risk that you have on hand. Procedures that we need to perform on account of COVID-19 from a going concern perspective would probably include an APCON broken into three parts. One is management's overall assessment of COVID-19. What is their plan? How are they assessing themselves at an overall level based on the government stimulus packages, incentives, their liquidity, their availability of the fund, committed arrangement that they have with the lenders or with their creditors or vendors who kind of perform services for them. So all of that needs to be seen from a management's overall assessment. What you need to do next is audit the cash flows that have been produced by the management by reviewing the impact of COVID-19 in respect to the assumptions as to how the growth of the business will happen from a revenue perspective, particularly when you're seeing a declining revenue. What's an impact of supply chain disruption? What's an impact of curtailment of the business that could have happened? When you look at all of this, also perform sensitivity analysis. So whatever the cash flows are projected, they need to be sensitized to see how much plus or minus could have an impact on the net results of the company. Ensure that the estimates used are consistent, such as the assessment used for impairment under Ind AS 36. From a cash flow perspective, the cash flow used for the purposes of going concern analysis should not be different. And then challenge the judgments and assumptions taken by the company, incorporate probability weightage to various alternatives to kind of compute different situations in which the cash flows could be impacted. Also specifically for this ask for management representation as necessary. Ensure that the disclosures under Ind AS 1 are appropriately produced in the financial statement. And as discussed, you have scenario one where you don't do any disclosures except basis of preparation. But in scenario two and three, your level of disclosures, both in respect of significant judgment applied as well as material uncertainty, needs to be well laid out. The external and internal consideration that would impact the overall assessment from a going concern perspective would include, from a government perspective, are there lockdown restrictions, stimulus packages, any regulation that get amended or are getting amended, supply chain, technology partners, service providers, what's really happening to them could also impact your reporting. Impact of consumer behavior, nature of industry, and the extent of the impact of COVID is very different. So for example, the entities which are running theaters have a significant impact, particularly because theaters are still closed. And the consumer behaviors could change where people would be okay to kind of see the movie using OTT platform within their own homes, right? And there could be internal considerations, which is like, are there working capital deficiencies? Do they have lack of staff availability? Are they not complying with covenant that they need to? A lot of those indicators needs to be looked into in specificity when evaluating how going concern could impact the organization. So just to kind of give you a perspective, at the time of auditing any company from a going concern and uncertainty perspective, look at how is government impacting the company, how their entities which they kind of operate into the ecosystem are impacting, how the external considerations are impacting them, and how the internal considerations in terms of their own capacity, need of capital, people, etc. is impacting them. Few of the procedures that I believe are important, I've kind of put it out here, is you should request management to perform assessment of entity's ability to continue as a going concern. In situations where the company has done that, have an informal ad hoc conversation with management on understanding how's the company managing their cash flows, what's really happened from a tax incentive, loan, any program in respect of loans or stimulus packages that's impacted. So that's the first kind of activity. Where the entity has performed the cash flow analysis, evaluate the reliability of the underlying data to prepare the forecast and to determine whether there's a adequate support for assumptions underlying the forecast. And typically, we assess the reasonableness of the assumptions taken into account, the uncertainty of the impact of COVID-19, and whether the management has done reasonable attempt to consider the potential downside that could happen on account of COVID. We would need to consider whether there are any modifications to contractual arrangement that may impact cash flow forecast, which means contract coming to an end, they're not getting renewed, etc., etc. You have a retail company, you have a lease contract, it's coming to an end, and there could be a potential that it may not get renewed, right? So how are those taken into consideration when you are putting together your cash flows? Consider the consistency of the assumptions and inputs which are being used not only for the purposes of audit engagement, but otherwise that the client or the company has used when they've gone back and taken loans from the institutions, or they've kind of performed impairment assessment of the organization's significant non-current assets. Check whether the assumptions addresses the disruption of supply chain, lack of availability of staff, delays in supplies. Have all of that been taken into account in one or the other way when forecast been prepared, and challenge the judgment and assessment made in the forecast. Consider contrary evidences that you may have obtained throughout the engagement based on what you have seen, the actual data information, to ensure that the information used in the cash flow is not contrary to what's really happening to the company or in the industry as large. Also, of course, review the bank covenants, how they're getting impacted, review the forecast included in the assumptions based on the expected timing of the future conditions, evaluate the sensitivity of the assumptions, ensure that any further deterioration or probability weighing into analysis that could have a significant change in estimation or increase the uncertainty in the current economic situation. If required, where required, depending upon the need, involve individuals with specialized skills and knowledge in valuations to assist you when you are doing this entire assumption testing altogether. You should also assess the impact of COVID-19 pandemic on management plans. So one is about the cash flows that's put into place, but what's the new plan? How are they going to be dealing with it? If they're not running the theaters, what are they going to do? Will they wait until the time the theaters are open out of government restrictions, or will they really go and do something else that would help them kind of sustain the company until that current time? The feasibility of those plans, the challenge on the feasibility of those plans are dependent upon several aspects of how entities within the industry operate, what kind of government stimulus package has been given to those individual companies within the industry, how has that changed their credit ratings, therefore they're impacting the compliance with debt covenants, or about their ability to continue to pay to their vendors, to their employees during this time, and to kind of meet all the statutory obligations, as well as what kind of commitment arrangements they have with the lenders for the short and long-term financing. Look at all of that, as well as the deferral of payments if they could in few of these cases. This will help to ensure that the management plan has been tested with the right amount of challenge that we need to do. And then ensure that you have taken tailored the representation letter to include these additional representations, particularly in respect of how the cash flow analysis have been put together, as well as how the management plan that's been taken into account will necessarily be met to form to the basis of going concern assessment by the company. So I would say, in a sense, the key takeaways that impact us in this given environment is our obligations do not change. Our obligations remain the same. We are expected to ensure that the financial statements are free from material errors and misstatements. Hence, we need to think through how we would obtain audit evidence to ensure that we are meeting our obligations, which would also mean that we highlight the potential issues early on with the management. We refer to the guidance and alerts issued by Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, as well as few other professional bodies across the world. Few of these guidances are absolutely amazing, both in terms of what needs to be done and how the disclosure needs to be reported. And the last and most important thing is that in case of going concern uncertainty and the COVID-19 impact, let's ensure that the documentation of disclosures in the financial statements is absolutely crystal clear and detailed for any reader of the user or reader or the user of the financial statements to understand the fundamentals of how the company has got to that conclusion that they've got. So those are the 4 or 5 key takeaways that are important from a perspective that we need to look at from an accounting and reporting perspective. So enhanced disclosures. And there are different ways in which we could obtain audit to get the same company. I know there are a couple of questions. I can kind of take them. If there are any other questions, please feel free to kind of add them up on the chat box. The first question is, what is the relationship between remote auditing and professional skepticism? Will it change due to remote auditing? It's a very good question. And let's understand, how does professional skepticism come into play in an audit? A professional skepticism comes into play in an audit to ensure that any reasonable risk of misstatement is being looked into in a way that neither you are saying that something has gone wrong or that something is not definitely wrong. You kind of do it very neutrally, right? In a remote auditing environment, the internal controls of an organization will change substantially or may have undergone change substantially. Such change in internal controls, typically, in my understanding, what we have seen in some organizations are very well documented and hence highlighted, trained to all the employees so that they can do what they're required to do in the remote auditing environment or remote accounting environment, remote operating environment, right? Versus we have seen companies which have not had a very strong mechanics of instituting the new controls in the remote operating environment, which the level of controls may not be as strong. The level of controls being less stronger than what they are should keep the professional skepticism high. Now, when we do remote auditing, a lot of this information that we obtain through remote auditing have seen by far and large are through email communications. And as I highlighted on previous slides, the more we have live video streaming, we have screen sharing, we are kind of having inquiries over video calls, etc., will reduce the chances of we going wrong from an audit perspective during this entire remote auditing session. So long as we keep those into consideration, we would be able to kind of ensure that the information provided to us during this period, the controls that the company kind of kept during this time in remote operating, as well as how we have looked at that data, particularly when you get the photocopies of the contract as compared to seeing the original contract, all of that should increase your professional skepticism and you should do enough work to ensure that the information provided to you from company's internal control perspective and your testing perspective is accurate. I hope that helps answer that question. There's another question. Can we get management authorization for electronic communication in MRL? which is representation letter. Can we get management authorization for electronic communication? Do we need to mention the email IDs of authorized personnel? Two things, yes. Electronic communication or authorization on electronic mode, we need to be clear of what are the mechanics of electronic communication which have been done. So long as they are digital signatures, which has been used, whereby management is authorizing for you to communicate with the customers or vendors or third parties to communicate electronically, that should be okay. That's not a problem. The standards allow you to do that. We should mention the email IDs of the authorized personnel who has approved the authorization document. But most importantly, what we need to do is to ensure that the email IDs of the third party to whom we are sending, the domain names and the email IDs are tested prior to sending those emails to ensure that communication between the auditors and the third party to whom you're communicating is the right person to from whom the response should be coming, which is no different than the paper environment where we used to go back and check the email and the postal addresses from the contract and then send across the letter. We used to mark out something on the letter to ensure that what's been reverted back to us is in that form. And of course, if we can use electronic mechanics to get the sign-offs done by the counterparty or third party, that's also perfectly fine. That would also ensure that there's a authenticity of where the communication went and how that came back. So you may end up not using emails, but you may use an email IDs, but you not use email to kind of do this confirmation, but you end up kind of using a different online system to kind of send the document and get it back. So there's a trail of that document going back and coming back, well documented with audit files. So these are the two questions that I saw on the screen. If there are any more questions, happy to kind of address them. What I would also want to do is I would want to share a small document on Excel sheet that's been prepared. Send this across along with the presentation. But when we do going concern assessment, how should we document the going concern assessment into our work paper files? As highlighted, there could be financial indicators, which is, you know, looking at net asset versus net current asset position at any point in time, looking at the debt position at any point in time, whether that will lead to an indication, any indication of withdrawal of financial support by the creditors, because we have also gone back and seen a lot of companies went and increased the period over which the creditors were paid. What's an impact on the cash flows?